So, hello everybody, I'm here. The title of my talk is When Life Gives You Orange, Make Data Speak Volumes. So, we learn about what orange is and how data visualization is something that we as developers, even at our individual levels, can use it in our day-to-day projects, self-projects, and go ahead with it. So, let me start by telling you a little about myself. So, I'm a computer engineer, I'm a tech geek, a social entrepreneur. I have a non-profit organization which works across three verticals in 10 cities across India. We have been featured in a lot of newspapers as well for our work that we do in the education, environment, and the healthcare sector. I personally wish to help the underprivileged children using technology so that they are able to use technology which is actually available to only the privileged people otherwise. So creating a space wherein they could come, learn, interact, and make the most of the technology that's available today. I'm an international speaker and also a mentor to a number of students. I conduct a lot of mentoring sessions, workshops, wherein people who are just starting off with their careers can come, learn, and collaborate and create projects which can help the world. Starting about what data mining is, many of you might be knowing about it a little bit, or some of you might have just heard about it as a tech jargon. So data mining is an autonomous process of discovering previously unknown patterns. These patterns should be valid. They should have some use to it, not necessarily completely commercial or enterprise-based, but these patterns should make sense. And these patterns should be able to tell us information about huge data sets that we might be working in. The process of data mining has four major steps. The first one is data retrieval. In data retrieval, we capture information from various sources. The kind of data that we could be working with, be structured, unstructured, semi-structured, quasi-structured, any of these. So, collecting all of these data from various data sources is the first step of data mining. The second one is data pre-processing. Data pre-processing involves various activities like cleaning, integration of data about one particular thing from various sources, as well as transformations and reductions. So data pre-processing comes handy wherein, especially when we are working with large data sets. We will realize that most of the features of the data set might have missing values. So we need to have a strong logic to either omit those entries with maximum missing values or have a process in which we are able to use various mathematical techniques like mean, median, mode for a particular column of the data set and replace the missing value with that value. All of that happens in the second stage of data pre-processing. The third one is data analysis. Data analysis is wherein we apply the logic or the algorithm, and we work with various features. We are trying to analyze data and make sense of it, get relevant information from data which can be used to develop solutions. And the last but not the least is interpretation. In interpretation, what we are trying to, what is our end goal? We are trying to achieve that. We're trying to interpret the analyzed data in order to get information which may be relevant to our business use case. Also, interpretation deals with prediction. So that interpretation may be used to just report, as well as that interpretation may be used for prediction of how our business line might move ahead in the future, in the next year or the next few years. Since we talked about data analytics, emphasizing a little bit more on that, there are four major types of data analytics. The first one is descriptive. In descriptive, we are trying to analyze data to answer the question of what is happening in my business. So our business is currently going on, and we want to know what exactly is happening. How are we reaching the goals of the customer? How are we able to use data efficiently? That kind of data analysis comes under descriptive type of data analytics. The second one is diagnostic. In diagnostic, we are trying to find the reason as to why is one particular product of the company working more than the other. Things like these. So why is it happening is the question that we try and answer when we are working with diagnostic type of data analytics. The third one is predictive. That is, what is likely to happen? One major use of data analytics is to predict the future. Each and everybody in this room, right, all of us want to know what the future holds for us. Similarly, in our business processes, we would like to have a process through which we would be able to analyze the data that we have till date and probably predict what is being, what would happen in the future. So that type comes under the predictive type of data analytics. And the last but the very important one being a prescriptive type of data analytics. As we want to predict about the future, but maybe we have to reach a particular goal and we need to backtrack. How do I reach that goal? What should be the change in my business strategy, in my model, so that I'm able to reach that goal? That comes under the prescriptive type of data analytics. And it answers the question, what do I need to do? Once we've answered this question, and we are answering this question using the analysis we are doing on our data. Many a times we tend to get confused between two terms of business intelligence and data science. So let me clear that out today. So when we are talking about business intelligence, that is about when the approach of analysis of data that we are doing is more of the explanatory side. And in the time frame of data that we are using is mainly past data that we are working on. At that time, it is business intelligence. Whereas data science comes into place when it, the approach is more exploratory type and we are working with data from present as well as trying to predict the future data. So these are the major two terms that we tend to hear a lot nowadays, but we tend to get confused. So I hope this clears it out and you are able to distinguish between what business intelligence is and what data science is. Since we are talking a lot about data, so huge amounts of data is called big data. There are three major challenges that comes along with handling big data. The first one being volume. The scale of the data with which we are working on. If you imagine any and every process that you do in your day-to-day life as well, you're generating a lot of data every day. Right from the clickstream data that you do on your phone, you are browsing through various apps, through various screens on the apps, you're continuously creating data. You're also, along with the data that you're posting or creating by writing blogs, along with that, you're creating a clickstream data, which is based on the user's activity of using a particular application. So because of that, the volume of data that we have to work with keeps on increasing by a huge amount every day. So that is a major challenge. The second challenge is the velocity, the speed at which data is generated. Each one of us uses at least 3 to 4 types of gadgets, devices every day, right from our laptops, computers, mobile phones, smart watches, to smart home lights, to our voice controlled assistants. There are a ton of options available to help with our everyday tasks in every field. Because of that, the velocity, the speed at which data is being generated has increased a lot. And the variety. There are a lot of data forms, right from structured data, semi-structured data, quasi-structured data. There are a lot of types of forms of data about one particular field. So we need to integrate those various data in different forms together to be able to predict and analyze data in the most efficient way. So these are the three major challenges that we face when we are working with big data. But all of this seems to be very complex, but the data gives out a lot of information that we might otherwise miss out. That is why we try and analyze data and make sense out of data by creating patterns. So coming to data visualization, if you do not have a lot of knowledge about the data that you're working in, maybe because it is that the data is belonging to a completely different domain than what you have previously worked in. But if you use data visualization to visualize the data, you will be able to make better sense of the data rather than just trying to interpret it by looking at the tables of data by the semi-structured way of data. So data visualization helps you in creating a visual picture of the data such that you will be able to effectively understand what the data is trying to say. It is a pictorial representation of data, and many studies have shown that we as humans are able to understand pictures better as compared to text. So that is the power that data visualization harnesses. It is also considered as the modern equivalent of visual communication. We are able to visually see the data that we are trying to analyze. Data visualization also gives us the ability to merge data from various sources, being of various structures, and being able to analyze them into specific data views that we wish to see. Some important factors while you do data visualization, the first one being colors. We might think that, okay, I'm displaying my data in the form of a bar graph or pie chart, so what is the need of adding many colors to it? Why do I put in that extra effort? But if you have colors in your data, in the data visualization, you will realize that that speaks out more. If this would have been a black and white image, you would have not shown that much of interest into trying to see what that picture is. But it being a colored picture, it directly attracts attention of the reader. The second one being discovering trends. In data, we need to understand the pattern that the data is going towards, or what is the trend in the data. For example, if we talk about cybersecurity threats to our application, we need to see the trend to which the data that our users are entering, which kind of threat it might potentially create in future. So it is important to discover trends, and data visualization helps you do that. Data visualization also helps you to comprehend information quickly. Say if I had just spoken a sentence as, there are two, referring to this picture, there are two types of crops being grown in a farm, separated by a tree and a small trail of no crops being grown. That would have not made that much sense as much as looking at this picture and seeing that, okay, one side shows that crops have yellow flowers and the other side does not. You are able to understand it very quickly. So that is the power of data visualization. Instead of just putting your results into text, if you visualize it using if you visualize your data, it will be easy for the reader and everybody to comprehend that information. The next is data visualization helps you identify relationships and patterns in data. You will be surprised when you visualize data and see that two factors which you must have thought are not very important to your business are actually the major factors which are affecting the way your business is going ahead. If you are playing around with data visualization, keeping two or three various factors on your X and Y axis while plotting data, you will see various trends. And seeing it visually, you will be able to say, okay, this also is an important factor that I should and all developers should keep in mind. So data visualization helps you identify various relationships and patterns. The major thing that we are trying to achieve is to finding the right balance while creating technology-centric applications and human-centric applications. Any application that you build should have both the things in a almost equal proportion. It should not be an over-engineered solution. The solution that you create should have the human essence to it. For that, you should include techniques of exploration, analysis to your model, as well as your technology, the actual algorithm that you are building, it should have that essence. So it is about finding the right balance between creating an application being technology-centric as well as human-centric. So let's see how we interpret data about cybersecurity breaches across the United States. So this is the data that we have. I'll give you a few seconds to just look at it. And so there are a lot of columns that you'll see, a lot of data that is there. But you're not exactly sure as to what is it trying to say. Was it difficult to read? Yes. It was difficult to interpret. You were not able to even make the basic sense out of that data. And then let's look at the same data being represented using mosaic display. So this shows you the US states on the y-axis and the number of individuals affected, along with a lot of colors. Is this easy to interpret? Because you are able to see the rectangles corresponding, the size of the rectangles being small or being big, which helps you in interpreting how many individuals were affected in which state. And that helps you gain information about it very, very quickly. So that is the power of data visualization. You must be wondering, there are so many things that are great with it, but what exactly makes a good data visualization? So it is a blend of the information that you have, the concept that you're trying to interpret, that is the story around the concept, and the goal. Is your data visualization being able to achieve the goal of displaying the data that you're trying to communicate to the end user, and the visual form in which you are representing the data? Sometimes bar graphs would be more effective, and in some other case, pie charts or mosaic displays or scatter plots might be more effective. So that is a decision that you as the developer has to take, which kind of visual form tends to display my data much more better, tends to display it more effectively. Let's look at the various objectives of data visualization. The first and foremost being that it gives you data in context. Having raw data will not make any sense to you or the end user of the data. So having data in the context in which you are working is of topmost priority. You should be able, using data visualization, you should be able to understand the data more clearly. An important factor that we might miss many a times when thinking about data visualization is that it might be used to illustrate as well as hide the data. So hiding data is very important many a times. If you are trying to understand your data considering, say, 5 features, but you realize that if you focus more on 4 features, you are able to achieve approximately the same results. So then why spend your time, your computation power working with 5 features? You might actually be almost, you might be achieving your goal by the same level even if you omit the 5th feature. So critical things like this can be achieved using data visualization to your data. And also it helps in making a comparison between the statistical data or even predict outcomes. There are various way in which you will be able to see what your data is trying to speak to you before actually going and using that data in your application. Let's look at the big data ecosystem. We talk about big data, but there are 4 major components of the big data ecosystem. The first one being the data devices. Data devices like cell phones, GPS, our computers, which are the creators of data, they produce data. The second one are the data collectors. Data collectors are like government, we given our information to the government for various official reasons. Our medical information, which is with the hospitals or the clinics that we visit, then internet, retail, finance, all of these are the data collectors, wherein they interact directly with the data producers, the data devices, and collect data. The third one are the data aggregators. Data aggregators aggregate data from various sources and may use it for advertising purposes or for media purposes. The fourth ones are the data users or buyers. These are media companies, law enforcement, employees, while recruiting as well. So those are the fourth and the final users in the big data ecosystem. So what we are trying to achieve through data visualization is to create a model or system which uses the computer ability as well as the human ability together. We are trying to build a model or a system which will have analytical power, predictive power, and the algorithm or the logic behind it using computer ability like data storage and the numeric computation that we do, along with the human ability of interpretation, domain knowledge, and creativity. Domain knowledge is something that only we as humans would be learning it. And we need to look at data from the domain knowledge that we have point of view. That would help in better interpretation and realizing, okay, this factor is very important when you're talking about, say, self-driving cars, safety reasons, which might not be known to a machine as it is. And your creativity in how you are able to interpret the visualization that you create using the data that you have. So for example, if you are talking about self-driving cars, in that case, your domain knowledge would be how are self-driving cars operated, how are the users using it, do we have sensors on the self-driving cars to send back inputs about, say, if the road is broken or if there's a road closure and things like that. So, and using all of that information, you will try and see, is your car safe enough to be there on the road? So this is where the human ability part of things comes into place. And using our human ability along with the computation power should create the best possible model that we wish to create. So why does data visualization matter? So three simple things: to take better decisions for your business processes. The second one is to have a meaningful storytelling. Just presenting data to your stakeholders would not make sense till the time you are able to completely convey the whole picture of how is this relevant to the business process, to what is this data trying to speak in literal terms, as well as the big picture of the interpretation that the data is speaking to us. And to create data literacy, because many times it might be possible that somebody who is reading the data visual, who's trying to interpret the data visualization, would not know about the domain at all. But still, you should be able to give them an overview of things and how this data aligns with that overview for that particular domain. So these are the three major things where data visualization comes into place. Also, data visualization helps us to overcome the unconscious bias that we might have in the data. And this unconscious bias is when you have your data being collected from sources which might exclude some other sources completely. In that case, you should create a model which is not biased and which would even cater to if the data points come in from the source you have neglected. So what is unconscious bias? So for example, you are trying to work with data with how plants are being grown in the soil. In that case, if the data that you have only is for places which have which are sunny 80% time of the year and have rainfall at the right times, you might create a model which will not cater to factors like what if it is a place that is very rainy and what if it is a place that is near to the beach. So the soil composition is different. You might completely miss out on these data points, and then you'll create a model which will not be able to correctly suggest or predict solutions for a situation wherein it heavily rains in that place. So this is a thing that we are trying to avoid, to try and avoid this bias in our data set. When you visualize your data pictorically, you would be able to see if the data is trending towards one particular thing. and then you having the human capability of interpretation and the domain knowledge, you will be able to visually see it that, okay, this data point should have been there, but it is not there. So it means that our model is being a little biased. Let's fix that. The most important thing of reducing bias is to be aware of the fact that we and our model might have unconscious bias. Till the time we do not have this thought in our mind, we will never pay attention to that. And if we are conscious that we might have unconscious bias in our program, in our model, then surely we'll give some time to check if there's bias or not bias. So the best way to tackle unconscious bias is to think about it consciously, to take conscious decisions to reduce the unconscious bias. Now coming to orange. Everybody was excited with the title that, you know, when life gives you orange, make data speak volumes. Orange is an open source data mining and machine learning tool that is available even on our Anaconda navigators. This is the official website as well, orange.biolab.si, wherein you can directly download it for your PC as well. Some of the key features of Orange is that Orange helps in data visualizations that helps uncover hidden data patterns. It also provides intuition behind the data analysis process. You have a choice of choosing between various models that you might want to train your data upon, whether you want to go with supervised learning approach, unsupervised learning approach, and what exact algorithm would you like to use for that is also freely available to you. And also, the data visualizations help communicate between data scientists as well as the domain experts. So you're able to create solutions which are efficient. Orange is a component-based data mining tool. The data analysis is done by stacking components that are called widgets. Like you can see here, we have a file, data table. All of these are called widgets, and they are represented with a little picture which speaks about the widget itself. And there are connectors between various widgets. And this one start to end process of a widget is called a workflow in Orange. Orange has an interactive data exploration. Orange widgets communicate with each other. They receive input and output from one widget to the other. So for example, here you can see that logistic regression would receive input, not directly from the data, but we have a scoring on the data that we have, and then that scored data would be input to the logistic regression. So all of this is controlled by the one who's developing it. So various widgets interact with each other through the input and output that they produce, which makes it very interactive. You can also select in data in your file widget and display the visualization corresponding to that data only. So if you see here, the file the data table is open and some rows are selected. And over there on the top, you'll see that the visualization has yellow color. It is for the selected data. Where are those data points in our whole visualization? So this is an interesting feature that is available in Orange, so that you can see that a particular some particular rows that you want to see, where are they exactly falling? So instead of manually spending time and locating those points, you can select them and see the corresponding position in the visualization there. Similarly here, if you're working with decision trees, and if you want to see what one arm of the decision tree is doing, you can have various arms being colored to be differently, and then see the corresponding colors in your visualization as well. It has a clever workflow design interface. There are so many technologies, and even this is an interesting technology. But you might think, okay, I'll have to spend in time, learn about it, learn about what widget can be connected to the other widget and what cannot be connected. But don't worry, you do not have to do that. It is a very clever design in Orange that once you extend the connecting arm from one widget, you will directly see a drop down of the compatible widgets with that. What this helps is also in avoiding creating an infinite loop in your workflow, because you do not want that to happen. So only widgets which are compatible to one widget can be connected to the other. If you know the widget that you want to connect already, then you can directly search for it. And if you do not, then you can explore between various options and see. It creates great visualizations. Any visualization you name has already been coded and developed as a widget already. So right from heat maps, box plot, to Silhout plot, everything has already been there. So many a times we get stuck up due to a number of choices that we have between choosing features to plot our data, to visualize our data. So at that time, what do we do? So at that time, intelligent visualization comes to our rescue. In Orange, intelligent visualizations are possible. There are score plots wherein you can score your data and see that what two features have a better score, and that will actually give a better pairing of which features to pair to visualize your data. In such a case, for example, if we are talking about, we'll see in a few minutes a demo, some demo of it to get a better understanding. Also, Orange supports reporting. So that you are able to version control the way you are visualizing data, and it covers all aspects of what you're trying to achieve. So for the demo, we'll see that this is how the Orange canvas looks like. On the left-hand side, you have all the widgets that you might want to include in your workflow. Currently, we have selected the file widget and have loaded data in the file widget. You can input your personal data as well, if you your own data as well. Otherwise, if you want to just try it out, there are a few data sets that come along with when you install Orange. And here is a workflow that I've created, wherein we are using the k-means clustering, and we are trying to visualize data. So this is the visualized data. Here you see I have opened the k-means widget, and I'm trying to see what is the value of k. So in k-means, a major critical part is choosing the value of k. That is the number of clusters in which you want to have your data being visualized. So currently, the k value is chosen to be 2. You can see that there is a fixed column. So for over there, we've given in 2. That's why our data has 2 clusters being represented by 2 colors of red and blue. But just below that, you'll see that there is a from as well. From 2 to 8 is written. So what that does is, if we select that, in that case, we will see a Silhout scoring like this, wherein you'll see that for 2, what is the Silhout score? For 3, what is the Silhout score? To give a context to how the Silhout scoring works is, so if there are 2 clusters, say A and B, and we need to find the Silhout score for one particular data point, so if the data point is near to, say, cluster B, in that case, the Silhout score will be higher. And if it is in the middle, it tends to 0. And whichever side it is more, that cluster would have a higher Silhout scoring for that particular data point. So that is being represented here. So if you have 3 clusters, so what is the Silhout score? This way, you do not have to actually physically go and visualize and see and decide the number of clusters that you would like to choose. You can directly see the scoring, and based on that, you can decide the value of k. So for example, k equal to 3 has the highest Silhout score. So representing our data as 3 clusters is the best option. So intelligent visualizations like these in Orange within the various components makes it very easy. This is very interactive for somebody who's just beginning with machine learning and wants to see how things work. How would it look like? Also, if you are a Python developer and are not much into the drag and drop interface. So you can use Orange as a library as well. So you can directly clone the GitHub repository. The link is available on the main website as well. And directly import it just as your normal Python library. So import Orange, and then you can use these various features in your Python code itself. So you can have your code, then use a bit of Orange code, have your code. So this will just be like an add-on to your existing project and code. Talking about an interesting use case of Orange. So Orange has been used in space-related studies as well. So the Hayabusa 2 asteroid sample return mission that was done, so samples were collected to understand more about the asteroid, and Orange was used in that process. This is a small part of the workflow design that was used for the Hayabusa 2 project. So here you can see that a lot of code as well of our normal Python can be used. You can see that represented by the widget with the Python symbol. So if you have a question in mind saying that, okay, can I have Orange data being Orange's feature being used, then have my own logic as well. So yes, you can do that and then visualize that. So you can mix and match. There are infinite number of combinations that you could do. You could have Orange do most of the work and then use your Python code with some other technique to visualize data, or you could write your code for the, you could write your main algorithm the way you like and then use Orange's data visualization features. You can do anything, it's just your creativity where you take Orange to. So there's one thing that I'd like to say, that you know, Orange has been used in space studies and Orange was built here on Earth. So why don't we Earthians use Orange in our day-to-day lives? These are the references and the attributes of my presentation. The first one is the official website. So how do you use it as a library, or if you want to find out about the new Orange updates and connect with the community or get help, so you can just visit the website. So I would just like to say that go ahead and make data speak volumes. Thank you.